Today is Divine Mercy Sunday, and we see Jesus out of mercy giving a chance to his disciples to see his glorified face and letting his face impart the best to those who are gathered on the day he appeared in the upper room. He came with reassurance to all of them. He came with new hope, and he came to announce a new start for that community that had gathered in fear. We have heard well how the gospel proceeded, and his coming into the room where they were hiding was a sign of his solidarity with them. He came to meet them, they who were fearful, they who were locked in fear, and very much afraid even of one another probably, and made a new community out of them. He mercifully handles them and creates a new force of love out of a team of people whom one can call a fugitive group. People who are cowards, people who are afraid. He brings the gift of his presence to bring them together in a new way, in a way of love and a way of life. He greets them, and his greeting is of imparting peace, a peace that the world cannot give, a peace of a special encounter with God, a peace that imparts grace to those who received it. And his coming and greeting them is, one can say, an invasion of grace. Grace that breaks in when we are locked in our fears to bring out of us a new force of presence, the presence of the risen Lord. Even as I speak now, from wherever we are listening, Christ is reaching out to us to create out of us a new community, never to be locked in fear, but be a community that brings out a new force of life, a new force of love, a new force of the presence of Christ. This is what happened in the first reading. These people received this new force of love and life, and they witnessed to the truth of the risen Christ powerfully, with great power. And signs were clear that these people were founded on a new spirit, and this spirit was in Christ. And after he greeted them with peace, he showed them his wounds. The wounds of our Lord do not stop on Good Friday, because they are important. They are carried forth to remind us of what Christ went through for our salvation. The cruelty he faced, the injustices, the violence, the hatred, and the self-absorption of the people, which are still alive in our communities even today. So we should never get afraid of looking as the wounds of Christ, and have the courage even to touch the wounded Lord in our brothers and sisters. And this is what St. John has told us in the second reading. Let's not run away from the woundedness of our brothers and sisters, because whoever touches with love brings life to a wounded brother or sister. And this is what it means to be a true child of God, a healer, one who gives good accompaniment to a neighbor who is in need. We know the story of the Good Samaritan. So Christ is telling us, as he allowed Thomas, touch the wounded brother or sister and bring healing. These wounds are important because they remind us as well that we are forgiven through the sacrifice that Christ offered for us. It is this sacrifice that made us acceptable again in the Father's presence. So let's honor these wounds and be happy when we look at them, because they are a cause of joy and hope for humanity. After showing him his wounds, he breathes peace on them. This peace is a peace the world cannot give. You can imagine a man who has betrayed, deserted, beaten, crucified and killed. One would imagine that when he returns, he would come with vengeance. Instead, he gives the gift of peace to tell those brothers who are in hiding that we are reconciled. Humanity is reconciled with God in a powerful way. And this peace that brings about the reconciliation that brings about peace is the peace we carry forth in our ministry in the world. This is the hope we should give to our brothers and sisters that we are still together. A peace that casts out of fear, that casts out suspicion, that casts out discomfort. And after he has breathed peace on them, he commissions them. But before commissioning them, he gives them the Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit, the Ruha of God. And this Spirit is what creates, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, this Spirit is what returns life to the dry bones in the book of Ezekiel. This Spirit is what returns life even in the fugitive group that was hiding in the upper room. This Spirit is what recreates us as a new members of the church, renewed in the baptismal waters. So this is the Spirit that brings about restoration, the Spirit that reminds us that God loves us, the Spirit that empowers us as ministers of the hope of Christ given in his resurrection. This Spirit vivifies. And after we have been vivified, we are sent out on mission. Because the gift we are given is not meant to be hoarded in our hearts. We have to give it generously, as the first Christian community gave out every gift they had generously for the good of others. This is where the Spirit leads us. If we welcome him, after being breathed upon us, we shall manifest a new way, in a powerful way, a way that keeps us away from accumulation to sharing, that keeps us out of controlling and keeping to almsgiving to the poor, a Spirit that gives us a gain of the common good from being self-centered. A Spirit that helps us never to withdraw into self, but be on a program of outreach for the good of others, a spirit that draws us out of indifference to practical concern and contribution to the welfare of others, a spirit that helps us to draw out of individualism to concern for all people. So when he breathes the spirit, this is the life he brings. He makes us messengers of mercy to others in a powerful way, in ways evident to all people to witness this new life. May God help us to live as people truly renewed in life, the life of the risen Lord, and help us to draw all people in the love of God that brings about newness and the reality of joy and peace in the risen Lord. The Lord be with you.